was the sound of church bells being rung rejoicing that marked the end of the Second World War 40 years ago. It was a sound that hadn't been heard for years, and you can join us on a trip back to May 1945 a bit later on. First, though, here's how we all went quackers this morning.
We said we'd be coping with a load of ducks today, and here they are, 150 of them. If you think this is a lot, just imagine what 15,000 would look like.
Because that's the number that's going to be floating down the River Severn this time next week. They'll all be taking part in the Great Ironbridge Duck Race to raise funds for the Ironbridge Gorge Museum. The idea is that you purchase one of these ducks from the museum for £1, then at 3:30 on Bank Holiday Monday, they'll all be released from a net at Albert Edward Bridge and raced down to the Ironbridge, a distance of 3/4 of a mile.
The prize for the owner of the duck that wins the race is a trip for two to Disney World in America, and what's more, the museum will be £15,000 better off. Now, if you're wondering how the judges are going to identify the ducks, well, they'll be all given waterproof numbers like this. And win or lose, you get to keep your duck at the end of the race. So, good luck to all 15,000 of them.
And from our duck-covered goldfish pond in the Blue Peter Garden, over to our wildlife pond.
Well, what do you think of it then, Percy?
Well, it should be a good frog pond. You see, it's in a nice, open, sunny position, and this is essential. It wants some finishing off, Ryan, to sort of make it more, look more natural.
It's a good size, isn't it?
Oh, it is, it is.
And what we've done is we've saved the rockery plants, so nothing has gone to waste.
Well, that's it. They can be replanted to cover these stones.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've had to leave the pond for a couple of days just to let it settle, but today's the big day we can put the tadpoles in. So do you want to take a jump?
Yes, thank you.
And
my word, these are going to enjoy this going into
this
bigger space.
They'll love it. Look at them swimming around there. Come on, all you go in.
That's
and
it.
The next one. They look great just running around there.
They'll thoroughly enjoy it.
Now, Brian Banks,
my word, yes.
Brian Banks said to leave the tadpoles in for a couple of weeks just to let them grow a bit before the newts go in, otherwise the newts might eat them.
Yes, they would do if they're very small. They could do.
Now, these rockery plants, is there any special way of arranging them?
Well, I brought a few extra ones along, Mike. You see here, the low-growing plants, to go along the edge there.
And beautiful colours.
They are. If we put these along like that, that's a saxifrage, a primula, a candy tuft, and so on. You see, this saxifrage is a little spreading plant, but it forms a nice cushion. Take him out of his pot and get these pink flowers all over the growth, and then put him in like that.
Couldn't be easier, could it?
There you are. I'm going to leave you to carry on.
Great.
And I'll have a look, see how these others are getting on with the sowing.
OK.
How's it going over there?
Now, Percy, am I sprinkling these thinly enough?
Yes, that's it. If you put them in too thick, then we've got to thin them, you see. By putting them in thinly like that, there's no need for thinning, and we can pull them and use them as we want them.
Right.
What about these carrot seeds, Percy?
Just the same. The thinner you sow, the better.
Right. Have we got this drill the right depth
as
well?
That's 1/2 inch to 1 inch deep for all small seeds like that, and then just cover them over, and they should come up like mustard and cress.
Right. Now, when we made that pond, we were very careful that we didn't harm any of the other crops, and the broad beans have come through pretty well, haven't they?
They have, you see. There it is. It's the dwarf broad bean, more there. There's one or two gaps. We shall have to push one or two more in just to fill the rowing.
Yes, I don't quite know what went wrong there. I'm a bit concerned about these potatoes. Do you think they've
had
their chips?
You see, Simon, it's a late spring.
Oh, that's
it's cold. They're there. They'll come up a few days and you'll see them pushing up through the soil.
Good.
So what else have you got planned for our vegetable plot, Percy?
Well, you've got lettuce, radish, a marrow, and the sunflowers to go in to make it complete.
You're still finding plenty of things for us to do then, aren't
plenty
you?
Of work
How are you
yes.
feeling now?
I'm feeling better, improving day by day.
Well, let's hope he does get very well very soon. And what a lovely thought, all those fresh vegetables for later on. When you watch the news and you see important people arriving in grand places in luxury limousines, I bet you don't give much thought to the drivers. But there's more to being a chauffeur than most people would imagine, as I discovered when I had some lessons at the home of Rolls-Royce in the Midlands town of Crewe.
A specialist driver is called a chauffeur, or for a woman, chauffeurs. My training started with an advanced driving test with Rolls-Royce's senior instructor, Peter Perris.
And you keep your hands parallel on the wheel the whole
right.
time.
The left hand must go no further than 12 o'clock, as the right hand must do the same.
We're coming into the town now.
Yeah, we're going downhill as well, you see, so we might have to reduce the speed still further.
To show that I was in complete control of the car and fully aware of other road users, I had to steer around the tight twists and turns of the town centre.
Zebra crossing now.
A chauffeur's must inspire confidence, and that means being able to cope with any road conditions. I had to concentrate hard behind the wheel of a £68,000 Rolls-Royce in the high street, but I was much more nervous when Mike suggested a spin on the skid pan. The skid pan car has bald tyres. On the surface covered with oil and water, I had to fight to keep control as the car started spinning.
Oh, just about got it back. Hand again, over you go. Super.
Is it testing my reflexes or the car?
Gently on the throttle, that's right.
The trick of controlling the skid is to turn the wheel the same way as you're spinning. With beginner's luck, I held on to 2.5 tonnes of precision engineering the first time round. But on my second attempt, the car got the better of me.
A little bit too slow then. Nice.
Good fun.
The next serious stage of my training was some basic maintenance. If a chauffeur's were carrying an important passenger and suddenly got a flat tyre, she'd have to be able to change the wheel. That's quite a heavy task when each one weighs 25 kilos and the hubcaps alone cost £100 apiece. In case of a breakdown, I'd also have to know my way around the engine. This never-ending dipstick measures the level of the Rolls-Royce's incredible 10 litres of oil.
Just over maximum.
Superb.
That's all right, is it?
It's fine.
How big is this engine compared to that on an ordinary car?
Well, this is 6,750 cc's, whereas the average family saloon is between 1,300 and 1,600 cc's.
Of course, no chauffeurs would be complete without a smart uniform like this one. I've had my driving thoroughly tested, and I know the car's ready for the road, but I think I'll just give it one final polish before I pick up my first passenger. A chauffeur's has to make sure that the thick pile carpeting with its individual footrests is clean enough to impress the most important of passengers, and that the high-quality leather seats are properly polished and treated. I was finding out there's more to being a chauffeur's than driving, and the car's mascot held a secret too. It disappears into the grill if it's knocked. Now my preparation as a chauffeur's was complete, and the time had come to take this incredibly expensive car out into the crowded streets of London's West End to pick up my first client. As I pulled up outside this impressive city residence, I still didn't know who my passenger was going to be.
Morning, sir.
Morning.
I was trying to keep to the cardinal rules of the chauffeurs. Be polite, stay cool, and get there on time.
And where to, sir?
To the recording studio, please. And I'm sorry, I'm late, so we'll have to fly.
Getting Alvin Stardust to a recording session was a stiff first test, and I hoped we wouldn't be delayed.
Oh, can you just pull in here a minute, please? I've got to pick up some shirts from a clothes shop.
Certainly, sir.
Important passengers are allowed to change their minds. Looking for somewhere to park in a hurry near Oxford Street on a busy Monday morning is a bit like trying to find a needle in a haystack. And even when I did find a space, there was no knowing how long it would take the traffic wardens to spot me. The last thing I wanted was a parking ticket on my first day.
Thank you. If you're hanging, I'll just be a couple of minutes, OK?
Very good, sir.
I was worried that his idea of a couple of minutes would turn out to be half an hour. Didn't someone once tell me that rock stars are always late? It was all very well for Mr. Stardust to stop and do some clothes shopping, but I was worried that I might get towed away, or worse. Only just up the road was a Metropolitan Police clamp unit, and it looked dangerously as though it was heading in my direction.
Yeah, of course.
With the minutes ticking away, I didn't think I'd be able to stay on the yellow line any longer. But just as I was going to drive round the block, Mr. Stardust reappeared.
It's okay, I've got it, thank you.
But even when the unexpected happens, a good chauffeur still has to keep her head, especially in the thick of London's traffic.
Oh, by the way, can you put the radio on?
Radio, certainly, sir.
Hey, that's me. It's my next record release. What do you think to it?
I think it's most catchy, sir.
And there are times when it pays to be especially polite.
Actually, you know, we're going to be far too late for this studio appointment. Can you take me to the Waldorf instead? Thanks, that was very nice. Was this your first day?
Yes, it was, actually.
Well, I can honestly tell you, you were very, very good. And I'd like to wish you good luck, and I hope you get a chance to drive with me again in the future.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I was delighted that I'd done a good job. Being told your service is satisfactory is the highest compliment a chauffeur can be paid.
Beautifully driven, Janet. You can take me to the theatre later, please. I tell you what, those traffic wardens out there look rather tough characters, but if you want to meet some really tough characters who would give someone like James Bond a run for his money, then why not watch the contest to find the strongest man in the world? It's on TV next Monday, and here are some of the amazing feats they perform. I don't think I'd like to get physical with any of that lot. I've never seen so much collective muscle. I wouldn't argue with any of them. However, I'm delighted to say we're very lucky to have Britain's Mr. Strongman himself here in the studio, but two paces from me, Jeff Capes, all 24 and a half stone off him. It makes Michael and I feel very puny indeed, just standing alongside. Welcome back.
Thank you. How are you?
Nice to see you.
Fine.
What we thought we'd do is have a demonstration of just how much stronger the likes of Jeff is than the likes of Michael and me by doing some rock lifting for real, as you saw in the contest there. Rock lifting is obviously very different to lifting weights on a bar. Quite unusual. Is it a more difficult technique?
Well, it's very much more difficult because you're on a bar, you've got the silver bar with the weight swivelling on the end, and it's far easier and technically easier to do. But on rock lifting, you've got it condensed.
Right.
And you've got it compact, and there's nothing to hold on to but the rock itself. So nothing can help you, not the spring or anything.
Mm. So what's the technique then?
You've got to be very physical, aggressive, and you've not got to let the rock win at all. You've got to take a good firm grip. Right. Take it to your chest, like that, and then in one good thrust, hold it out, two, down, and then put it down again.
Looks as though it's made of polystyrene.
No, it's not. It's real. It's real.
Feet wide apart, is
right. Feet shoulder width apart so you don't topple over.
OK, yeah. Well, after you, Simon.
Can I get the first
after
go?
You, right.
Right.
I'll be referee.
Here we go, then. So it's straight up to the chest.
Step to the chest, yep. Two movements. Get your hands underneath.
Right.
Bend the knees.
Two, good push, thrust. Go. Up.
Yes,
yes,
well
good lift.
Done.
Down.
Clean.
Down.
Great. That's...
Yeah. Just like a professional.
All right, now that's 36. Should 36 I go for 39 or 42?
I think you want to go to the 42 kilos.
You can
shorter.
Do
shorter. You used to be a gymnast, and all gymnasts, if I remember, was strong.
Oh, yeah. I wish I was. It's my legs from trampoline that are the strongest.
You can do it, Michael.
I'm sure you can do it. Grit your teeth.
That's well done.
It. Fine.
Well done.
Good lift. Up you go. Good.
Good lad. Very good.
Hold on. Steady.
Yeah.
Down. Good, and down
still
to the floor.
Still quite hard, isn't it?
That looked very,
very
good.
Awkward to me.
Superb. I think you'll make a good strongman. Yeah.
You saw what a struggle it was for me to lift 42 kilograms and Simon 36. but have a look at this rock here. It's 69 kilograms. So, Simon, would you like to have a go?
I was going
to
say, I'll lift your belt for you.
No.
I don't know. All right, I get the first go again, do I?
So, all right. First go.
I get the picture. One, two, three. Up.
Yeah,
I don't think it's going to go any more. In fact, I think even with two of us, it's certainly not going to go
above our heads.
Have you finished, you two?
Yeah.
What do you say? What are you looking about at?
Well, let's see that habit expert, Jeff, and all your bulging muscle. Let's see what you can do with it.
Again, you mustn't let the rock win. You've got to be in control. You're in command, OK? So, again, very quickly, pick it up to the chest. Good firm grip. Bonk.
Great. Well done.
Well done, yeah.
Excellent.
Congratulations.
Excellent. There it goes.
We could have done with you when we were moving our rockery the other day.
Well, can I take it back? I'm building a rockery.
All right. We would have got it done in half the time.
Thank you.
Seriously, I don't recommend that you try lifting huge rocks like this yourself. There is one trial of strength that you can try at home, and that's arm wrestling. Here's how it's done world championship style, with Ingmar Kustar of West Germany taking on Inge Gustafsson of Sweden.
Keen arm wrestler. Well, here's something that will really help you learn better, to do it better.
Yep.
Any useful tips there, Jeff?
Yep. Well, we've got a professional table where the man must keep his elbow in the cup and he mustn't take it out of the cup. And also, he's got a block there to put the opponent down to so he doesn't hurt himself. You've also got a handle to hold on. Stop fidgeting over there.
Handle to hold. Grunt?
Oh, you're going. You're ready.
On,
oh, you're competing. Right.
I started right, about 3 minutes ago.
The knuckles must be clear of each other as well. And he's...
Come on, Simon. Yes, yes, well done.
I think I had a bit of help there, just a little bit of help.
Well done. The winner. Sorry. Didn't mean to do that.
A weaker man, but if you've got good technique, do you think that helps a lot?
It does help, obviously, technique. Smaller man, body weight, probably disadvantage. But if he's got a good technique, it could help. In fact, you could probably take him on at equal terms.
Equal wreck now. This is ridiculous. Okay, right. A blue piece of arm wrestling competition. You're going to be the judge.
I'm referee.
Referee.
You don't start until I tell you.
What about this thumb business?
Thumbs in.
Is that right?
Yeah, joint showing all the time, okay? Wrist straight.
Right. Now,
handles on there.
Right.
Okay, no headbutting, no scratching. Okay.
Right.
All right.
You ready? When I say... Sorry?
Am I at a disadvantage because he's got longer arms than me?
Well, you can manoeuvre about in that cup to get your... angle down, okay? You ready?
Yeah. Ready?
You ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Good. Get set. Go.
Have you started yet?
He's started now. He's gritting his teeth. He's moving the weight. He's moving his feet. He's pushing his weight over one side. That's it.
Oh,
the farm boy. The farm boy is the winner.
That was great fun. Thank you very much. Well done. Great fun. Thanks a lot.
Are you men or mice? I'm not taking part in this, of course, because I wouldn't want to embarrass anyone with the ease with which I win. But you can see the whole of that contest on Bank Holiday Monday. And you might think that town it's being held is a bit familiar. That's because it's Mora, the home of Santa World. And if you're one of the top runners-up in our Winter Wonderland competition, you'll be delighted to know that your entry forms part of a splendid exhibition. It's being held on the top floor of Santa's factory, and it's really attracting the visitors, about 7,500 per week so far. There's a Blue Peter sign, an explanation in Swedish as to what the programme's all about, and all the entries are arranged in their age groups.
And Juan, when we were filming at Mora, we were disappointed because there's no snow. But it's all changed. This is what Santa World looks like now. And this is what it should have looked like when I was filming Santa World just before Christmas. But Europe was having very unusual weather then, and there wasn't a snowflake to be seen. The building's progressing very well, and with a bit of luck, Beverly Room's Winter Wonderland should be constructed next year.
Looks lovely, and we've had loads of letters and cards from Blue Peter viewers who've already visited Mora, and they say that Santa World is magic. 40 years ago this week, people in Britain were planning to celebrate VE Day. VE stands for Victory in Europe, and that was the great day that the Second World War ended in Europe with the defeat of Nazi Germany. People at home, it was 11 months after D-Day, of course, which was the great invasion that started with the battle to free France, and people at home followed the campaign on maps like this, pinned to their living room or bedroom walls, so that they could chart the advances. In the weeks leading up to VE Day, there was no doubt about the result of the war. Nazi Germany had been brought to her knees by the combined might of the Allies, which included America, the Soviet Union, Great Britain and the countries of the Commonwealth. The only question was, when will it finally end? The papers were full of war news, and of course the papers in those days were very small and rather thin because of the paper shortage, but people read them eagerly. And on the front page of the Daily Sketch for exactly 40 years ago, the headline read, "It's only a matter of days, perhaps of hours now." In fact, VE Day was still a week away, but nevertheless, peace victory celebrations were already in full swing.
Later that week, the Daily Sketch carried the headline, "Hitler is dead. He died in action in Berlin." Of course, it's now known that the evil dictator Adolf Hitler, who started the war and led the Nazis in Germany and began a war in which 50 million people died, was not killed in the fighting. He killed himself in his underground headquarters as the Russians approached his capital, Berlin. And that was news that the British people had longed to hear.
And the Daily Express for 40 years ago carried the banner headline, "The Last Hours." The final surrender of the remaining German forces will probably take place almost immediately. And indeed it did, 2,074 days after World War II had begun. The next day was declared VE Day, and Winston Churchill, the Prime Minister who had led the nation from the worst period of the war, spoke over the radio to the people of Britain.
Hostilities will end officially at 1 minute after midnight tonight, Tuesday, the 8th of May. We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing.
The actual surrender of the German forces to the British Army in northwest Germany took place inside a tent on a windy heath. Five German officers arrived to surrender to Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery, known to everyone as Monty.
That is the text of the instrument of surrender. Now, I will sign the instrument on behalf of the Supreme Allied Commander, General Eisenhower.
And this is the actual surrender document signed on that very day 40 years ago. And this historic document records the unconditional, that's the total and complete surrender of the German forces. A very precious piece of paper, and we're very grateful indeed to the Imperial War Museum for lending it to us. It was all done in rather a hurry, in such an extent that Monty actually had to write in his own handwriting in the last moment this sentence. And he also put the date wrong, so he had to cross it out and rewrite it. And when this was signed, the fighting in Europe ceased and the victory celebrations could begin.
The whole country joined in an outburst of joy, relief that the anguish and pain of the last 6 years was at last coming to an end in Europe. The war was not over yet. Fighting with Japan went on in the Far East for another 3 months. But in Britain, everyone knew that there would be no more wailing sirens warning of air raids, no more submarine attacks on the country's precious food convoys, and that soon the millions of men and women who had served the country would be out of uniform and coming home.
So on VE Day, everyone allowed themselves that moment of celebration, and they held street parties and made banners and wore the colours of the Allies on scarves like these and on their clothes. And as well as hearing church bells for the first time in all those years, they also heard, for the first time in 6 years, a weather forecast, because up until then, the weather forecast had been secret in case they helped the German bombers. But although peacetime had returned, it was a while before some things returned to normal.
It took months, even years, for all of the men to leave the armed services. And when it was your turn to leave, you got given one of these, demob suits, which is short for demobilization, because most of the people had been in uniform for so many years, they didn't have any other clothes to wear. Demob suits aren't made to measure. You just had to take whichever suit looked your size. And that's why so many demob suits fitted their owners so badly.
During the war, people were asked to take great care about what they threw away as rubbish in their dustbins, because rubbish could help the economy. And even after the war finished, the message, "Don't waste waste," carried on. This was a typical wartime poster of the period. But this one here is saying, "One ton of waste paper will make ceiling board for 12 houses." And this sort of poster was looking ahead, looking forward to peacetime, and also looking forward to the better future that everybody hoped for.
But that better future took a long time to come. Britain was broke. All the money had gone into fighting the war, and food and clothing were in short supply. Rationing didn't stop until 1954, 9 long years after the end of the war.
And it's worth remembering that among all the people celebrating VE Day, there were millions whose feelings were tinged with grief because their loved ones weren't coming back, but had died in the most widespread and bloody war that the world has yet seen.
If you're visiting London next month, you could go to the Imperial War Museum and see the VE exhibition. It's on from the 4th to the 15th of May, and it's absolutely free to get in.
And it really does give a fascinating glimpse back to see what life was like after the Second World War and on VE Day. We'll be back on Thursday, and we'll all be in for an energetic time again.
Right, so see you on Thursday.
See you then. Goodbye.
Goodbye.